is a message about, is about the message that we're to share with the world, but it is also about the messenger that we are in Christ. It is a message about the perils of sharing the gospel, but it is also a message about encouragement and motivation to do so. It's a message about humbleness because of the feebleness of the humanity, but it is also about power and authority which we have in Christ Jesus. But before we engage in this journey, let us bow down for a word of prayer. Father, today, we want to ask you to show us our identity in Christ, who we are in Christ. How are we to present ourselves to the world? What message are we to present to them? Where our citizenship lies? And what is the hope of your coming? Pray, Father, that you bless us at this hour. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So please open your Bibles in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. We'll be focusing on verse 19 to 21. Now I will read from my personal interpretive translation, comparing to what you have in your Bibles. You may notice a couple of differences which I will point out. So it reads, what I mean, verse 19, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. What I mean is that God was in Christ, that is, by means of Christ, reconciling the world to himself. And how is he doing this reconciliation? But not holding their trespasses against them. And he has entrusted unto us, that us is Paul and all his associates, all the believers, the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we, all believers, are ambassadors on behalf of Christ, just as indeed God was and is still entreating or making his appeal to us with the following words. This is the message that we communicate to the world. Follow there. It says, we implore or beg on behalf of Christ that you, that is all the people of the world that are not reconciled to Christ, you refers to them, that you be reconciled to God, who made the one who did not know sin to be sin for our sake, so that we might become in him the righteousness of God, that is the right righteousness that proceeds from God, and that we also manifest to the world. So it is the righteousness of God communicated by God to us, and then communicated to the world from us. So it is the righteousness that proceeds from us, from God, and that is manifested in us and through us. This text says something very peculiar. Here it says that we are ambassadors. That is correct. You and I are ambassadors of God. But what is an ambassador? The word in Webster's dictionary is defined as a diplomatic agent of the highest rank, accredited to a foreign government for a special temporary assignment. Now there are 3 points that I want to point out here in this definition. Point number one, it says that it is the highest rank. And keep in mind also that we are joint heirs with Christ and that we are royal priesthood. We are of the highest rank. We are children of God. Second point is that we're working in a foreign government. Jesus Christ said that his kingdom is not of this earth. Jesus Christ also said that, in the Bible, it also says that, Hebrews 11 says that the followers of God did not yearn for another city here because they have a city which has no foundation from human hands, whose founder is God himself, because we yearn for that heavenly city, because our citizenship is in heaven. So we're foreign people in this land. Point number three, we're on a special assignment. And in this special assignment, we have a special ministry, as we read, the Ministry of Reconciliation. And we also have a special message, the message of reconciliation. In other words, the gospel. So, we're going to discuss these points one by one. The first point says, an ambassador is an agent of the highest rank. Now, almost everyone in America knows what's going on with ISIS, with Syria. Syria has a lot of people right now flocking out of there, going into Europe, into all other continents of the world, seeking for refuge. Because they have ISIS on one side trying to take over, and then they have what is considered an authoritarian president, Assad. So the people are not very content with the situation there, so they're just flocking to all places of the world. So, in Syria, we did have an ambassador until the year 2014. The name of this ambassador was Robert Stephen Ford. He was the ambassador for 3 years. And as an ambassador in Syria, he was the official representative of the President of the United States of America. And his official title, pay attention to this, I didn't know this, his official title was Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary. Plenty meaning all, potentiary, all power. So he had all the power. He was fully representing Obama in this foreign land. So he was the person in charge of communicating the interests of the United States of America in that foreign land. That our interests will be heard and heeded. But in 2014, he left his post saying these words. He said, I was no longer in a position where I felt I could defend American policy. We have been unable to address the root causes of the problem. So since he got there, he was calling for support. He said, you do not need to leave Iraq. Because once you leave Iraq, there is going to be empty space that is going to be taken by some terrorist groups. If there is no controlling power, that's what's going to happen. And so he was calling for some moderate resistance to Assad. But that was denied him. No assistance was given to him, and effectively we know that ISIS came about. So two things we must note here. Number one, he was the plenipotentiary. He was the highest representative in this foreign land. And he saw for the American interest. In a place where authority was being challenged, you know, ISIS is trying to take the power, Assad is trying to take the power, and the people are trying to have somebody who's in power who also listens to them. So there, our ambassador was trying to show America's power and authority in this place until he said, I can't do it no longer. And lest we may be imposing some anachronistic understanding of the word ambassador, let us see what the contemporaries of Paul taught or understood by the word ambassador. And who here has not heard about Philo? Philo was a Jewish contemporary of Paul. And he writes in Latin, because he was now working for the Roman government. He writes this book called De Vita Moses, meaning the life of Moses. And in this book, he writes, and he says the following thing in reference to ambassadors. He says, according to the Greco-Roman customs of the time, he says, an ambassador, the one sent out as an ambassador, fully represented the originator of the message. He was the full embodiment of the sender's authority in the alien nation. Do you see those words? He was the full embodiment of the sender's authority. And so it is for you and I. We are the representatives of the king, the representatives of the king of kings. And we are in a foreign land, for our citizenship is in God. I am not the only immigrant, the only alien person here, I, a Colombian, in American soil. But we are all immigrants, we're because our citizenship is in heaven. So, today, where the legitimacy of ordination of ministers is challenged, where political correctness seems to place all religions as equal, where nations and terrorist groups are seeking to destroy one another for power and control, where does our authority as Christians come to share the gospel, to share to the world that our message is the because we're commanded to do so. So we find this in our very identity as ambassadors of Christ. Let us now read, starting on verse 17, 2 Corinthians chapter 17, chapter 5, verse 17 to 20. And I will skip, just for emphasis purposes, a couple of the words. So in verse 17 it starts, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. You and I in Christ are new creatures." And in verse 18, "And all these things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ." So we are a new creature, we're reconciled with God. "And he has given us the ministry of reconciliation." We're given an assignment, a ministry. What I mean is that God was, by means of Christ, reconciling the world to himself. "And he has committed unto us, as Paul and all believers, the message of reconciliation." Now, the word here, "therefore," is the word in Greek, "on." And it says, "Therefore, we are ambassadors on behalf of Christ." So this is how the pattern follows. We are a new creature. We're reconciled with God. We receive a ministry. We receive a message. Therefore, as a result, we are ambassadors of Christ. All of us are ambassadors of Christ. And the word ambassador here is the Greek word presbeomen, which comes from the verb presbeo, which means presbyter. And this word actually in English will be to be an elder. Now we have verbs that are stative and verbs that are of action. So when I say I work, it is an action that I am doing. But when I say I am a white Hispanic, that is just a stative verb. That's just what I am. I cannot change it. And this word, in essence, we can see that it's a stative word. So once we're a new creature, we receive the message, we become an ambassador of God. That is who we are. That is not a title. That is who we are. That is our new identity in God. We are forgiven, made into a new creature, given a ministry, a message, and as a result, we're now ambassadors. According to Paul, at this time, he is not, ambassadorship is not one of his roles. It is who he is. It is his identity. His and his associates. Now, if we apply this, because we read that God was through Christ reconciling us to himself, and this refers to everybody. So, in the world, this is a nomic verb. It means it refers to everybody. So when we look at the sun, we say the sun shines. We mean the sun shines constantly, all the time. It doesn't cease to shine. And so when God reconciles to a believer, this is also a nomic verb. He reconciles to all the believers through Christ, and immediately they become ambassadors. This applies to all of us. We are all ambassadors of Christ. And I want to emphasize that point. It is not the pastor. It is not a few. All of you, once you're in Christ, you are his ambassador, your representative of Christ in this world. Brothers and sisters, that is your identity. You're Christ ambassadors. You're given power and authority from God. Are you using that power? And this is what the entire New Testament teaches. Matthew tells us that Jesus received all authority in Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20, and then he gave us the authority. In some manuscripts, in Mark 16:17, the Bible affirms that signs and wonders accompany those who believe. That is power. In Luke 24:49, the Bible says that when Jesus is speaking of the Holy Spirit, he tells the apostles, "Stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from high." We receive power from high. John says, we are children of God. Is there not authority and power in that? John 1:12. While Paul affirms that as children, we are heirs together with Christ. In Romans 8:17. And then he also says that we're seated with God in heavenly places. Do you want to hear more about the authority that the Christian has in this world? And this is plenty of evidence that we are given power and authority by God himself to proclaim the gospel of Christ above all religions. kingdom come, pray Jesus. So we pray today, oh Lord, let your kingdom come through your church, through me today. Now in case we may be tempted to let all this power and authority get to our head, we must listen to Paul's admonition in this very same letter, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Listen to his words. He says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency or the all-surpassing power of God may be of God and not of us." So here Paul sets the record straight. The power and authority that we have is not our own. It comes from God. Yes, we can be victorious over sin only when we're in Christ. Yes, we can resist Satan, as James says, but only when we cling to God first. And this is why the church is the body of Christ. Because each individual believer, as an ambassador of God's kingdom, is the embodiment of Christ here on earth. We're God's body. We have the power and the authority. We're the full embodiment of our sender, Christ himself. So, because the Bible says, "It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." Let us now move to the second aspect of the ambassador, living in a foreign government. This is our point number two. And since we're living in a foreign land, it is our interest, our responsibility to see that the interests of the heavenly kingdom are carried out in the world as well. Jesus said, "Think first of the kingdom of God and his righteousness." And that is indeed our main role as ambassadors. So as an ambassador of Christ, we're representatives in foreign land, planet Earth, which by and large have not accepted the sovereignty of God himself. But we're to communicate that he is indeed the ruler of the universe. Now my job in the army, some of you may know that I am in the army, and my job is called civil affairs. And in civil affairs, we are the experts in culture. So when we go to Iraq or South America or Africa, we are the go-to guys for the commander to find out anything about the culture, anything about the needs of the locals. And we do, I call it, well-founded missionary work. Because we build a whole lot of schools and hospitals, and we build roads and all these things that we take for granted here in America, and all these places where they don't have those things. So, just got a little bit outside of the topic. So, they tell us two very important things as we go there. They tell us, number one, you must watch your reputation because you are representatives of the United States of America. And number two, you must not go native. You ever heard that term? Don't go native. Which means, do not take on so much of their culture that you forget your loyalties to the United States of America. And it is the same thing for you and for me. We must know what are the needs of the people out there. We must know what are their customs. We must know what are their needs. What are their things they enjoy. Not so that we take on those things, but that we know how to provide the care they need for those things. So we must be the cultural experts. We must be involved, socially involved in what's going on outside of the church, not being in closed doors. In reference to the reputation, in this letter, is known by the scholars that Paul is speaking at length about his ministry and his reputation, starting in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, and running all the way onto chapter 7, verse 4. Because, this is very important, the message of the gospel should be incarnational. We're part of the message. If we're sharing that God can transform lives and we're not leading that transformation, how is people going to believe it? So the message is intrinsically joined with us. And we can find that in this text as well, which I will share with you in just a minute. So, in reference to not going native, Paul, after he speaks at length about his ministry and his reputation, he says, he warns the Corinthians not to intermarry with non-believers. For what does light have to do with darkness, says Paul. This is his version of don't go native. Don't join yourself to them. Don't follow the customs of the land. You're no longer part of that. Your heavenly citizenship is in heaven, and that is why you're Christ's ambassador. Then be one. That's pretty much what Paul is telling you. So as an ambassador of the land, or normal human ambassador, and as civil affairs, we are to be the experts in this foreign land. We are able to blend with the people. When we go out there, you imagine always soldiers have guns and weapons and all these things. We don't. When I go in civil affairs, we don't. We're actually very vulnerable because we're going there where people may be a threat to us, but we want to present a friendly face. So we go with no weapons, putting our life at risk. And so we're able to blend in with the people a little bit more. We know their cultures, we do their practices, as long as they don't go against our convictions, but we get to know them better. And we Christians, as I mentioned earlier, must be aware, must be friendly to the people of the world. And our third point says that we are on a special assignment. So we have this special ministry, the ministry of reconciliation, and this special message, the message of reconciliation. According to Paul in this letter, what are some of the motivations for us to do this ministry? And we, as I mentioned earlier, we're intrinsically connected with the message. And the message is in the power is not only in who we are in Christ, but it's in the message itself. The power is in the message. There is something very peculiar about this message. Let us read in verse 18 and 19, which are parallels. Stay in the same chapter, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 and 19. We read, "All these are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Christ Jesus, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation." Now we move on to verse 19. We skip the first words, and then he says, "And he has entrusted unto us," as Paul and all believers again, "the message of reconciliation." Now the words here for entrusted unto us, they are temenos en hymen. Literally it means given in us. It doesn't say given to us, it says given in us. Which means that God placed the message inside of each one of us. It's an incarnational message. The message, we're supposed to live the message. We are part of the message. In Romans, Paul says, and this message has a lot of power. Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes." So there is power in the message. In Corinthians, when speaking about the Holy Spirit, who's also in us, he says, "For we have this treasure, Holy Spirit, and the message in earthen vessels, that is our bodies, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us." So there is power in the message, not only on who we are in Christ, but there is power in the message also. For both, the message and the Holy Spirit abide in us. Now, there is also power in the message because it is the will of God, and the will of God always gets carried out. So when we read on verse 18, pay attention to these words, it says that all these are of God. You know, they come from God. And what are these things? It is what he has been speaking before this and a little bit after that. So in verse 14, it is God who gives the ministry. In verse 14 and 15, salvation is from God. In verse 16 and 17, regeneration and sanctification are from God. In verse 18, it is God himself who reconciled us to himself. Verse 19, it is God who justifies us through Christ, through Jesus Christ's death. Verse 20, it is God making an appeal through us. In verse 21, it is God who made Jesus sin for you and for me so that we may receive the righteousness of God. So never are you more in line with the will of God than when you're sharing by word and deed the gospel. Because it is the will of God that these things be so. So reconciliation is by the will of God, and his will be fulfilled. Therefore, there is power in the message. And I am so glad that we don't have to convince God to receive us, to reconcile with us. He's willing to do so. The Bible says that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. Isn't that amazing? Doesn't that deserve an amen? We do not need to convince God to be reconciled with us. Foul sinners as we are, He's willing to give His very life to be reconciled to us. His message, there is power in that message. There is power also in the validity of the message, because it provides a fit solution for humanity's problem. So reconciliation is by the act of forgiveness. As God forgives our sins, we reconcile to Him. And how can God do this? In verse 19, we read that it is by not counting the trespasses against them. That is the only possible way for you and me to be reconciled with God. He has set our sins aside, because the only thing that can keep us apart from God is our sins. As we know, the Bible says your sins have separated you from God. But in Christ, in the person of Christ at the cross, He does away with that wall of separation between you and God, between me and God. So what is the problem here? The problem that we all have is that we are sinners. And this puts us at odds with God. But I have good news for you. You can be reconciled to God today. He can forgive your sins forever. He can judge you free as if you had never sinned. And He can give you eternal life. You know, some people preach the gospel in the following manner. And mind you that I did come to the church through Christ through one of these books. It's called A Purpose-Driven Life. So this is their version of the gospel. You know, this is a version of the gospel. Do you want to have a purpose in life? Is that really what we need? A purpose in life? I think so. Or do you want to have a better marriage? Is that all we need? There's more that we need. Yes, a good marriage is important, but that's not the main problem of humanity. Or do you want to strengthen or do a better slice on the golf course? Do you want to improve in life as a whole? Some people preach the gospel as if it was prosperity preaching alone. But that's not our main problem. The main problem is that we are sinners that need reconciliation with a holy God. The issue at hand, as God sees it, is do you want to die in your sins and suffer the second death, or are you interested in full and complete forgiveness and eternal life? That is the message that we're to share with the world.
Amen.
It is as if God is pleading through us, says the word, we implore, we beg on behalf of Christ, you, all sinners who are not reconciled to God, be reconciled to God. That is the message. Why? Because God made the one who did not know sin to be sin for our sake, so that we might become in Him the righteousness of God. So there is power because God is the one who's pleading with man.
Amen.
Did you grasp this? God is begging sinners to be reconciled. Did you ever catch that word? God is begging sinners to be reconciled. And there is power in this because who's the active speaker here? It is God Himself speaking through you and me. So when we communicate the words of people that said Jesus, we should not take pride that it was our doing. Because it is God who is speaking through us. He is the agent of power behind the words I speak to you today. The speaker here is the very same speaker that spoke the world into creation. And He will create a new heart in you as well. So, what do we mean by God begging, right? Some may ask. And that's exactly what the text says. God is a beggar pleading with sinners. And brings to my mind Jesus Christ when He said, "Oh Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I wanted to gather you under my wings, but you will not." God is a beggar. He wants you to come to Him. God is pleading with man. And there is also power in the ministry. And Paul tells us at least three motivations presented in this very same chapter of why should we go through ministering to other people the gospel of Christ, and with our lives sharing it. There are three motivations that he shares here. The first one is the imminent judgment. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. So he says, "For we, all of us, must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Therefore," he says, "knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade man." So there is a judgment coming up for you and for me and for everybody. We're aware of this, we fear the Lord, and we want to go and share it with the world. We want to persuade them not to be foolish. For Paul himself in another letter said that there is a day in which God will judge the world. He has given us assurance of this by raising Jesus Christ from the dead. So before this, in time of ignorance, God overlooked. But now that we know about Jesus, he has commanded all men everywhere to repent. And he gave us assurance of this judgment in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, which is the main foundation for our faith, Jesus' resurrection. So, for God has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. So, the impending judgment, the imminent judgment, is crucial and a fundamental part of the gospel, the proclamation of the gospel. Did you ever think about that? Because when you preach the gospel of salvation, you're telling people you're going to be free in this judgment. You're going to be set free. You're not going to be condemned. It is primordial to preach reconciliation with God and judgment hand in hand. For we are saved from being condemned in this judgment. That is why Jesus Christ says, "He who believes is not condemned," John 3:18. Furthermore, there is no secret for Adventists that who believe in the proclamation of the three angels' message. What is a peculiar parable? It's the judgment, right? We say, "Repent, for the hour of his judgment has come." Then there is also motivation number two, the Holy Spirit and eternal life. So this is very interesting, because sometimes when the going gets tough, right, and we don't feel like doing things, Paul gives us a word of encouragement. He says that when we are losing courage and losing hope, our hope should be based on two facts. First of all, we have the promise of eternal life, and God gave us assurance of that, second point, in the Holy Spirit, which he uses as a guarantee. I will repeat this again in 1 minute. So, on September 11th of 2012, Christopher Stevens, I want to illustrate this, Christopher Stevens, the United States ambassador in Libya, was killed in Benghazi. We have heard this a lot, right? So, this occurred in Libya. He, along with three other Americans, were killed in a horrible attack. And there has been so much political turmoil about this issue, but one thing has never been contested, and it is that Christopher Stevens was killed while serving as an ambassador of the United States of America. That is a fact. And Paul was such a kind of ambassador who finally gave his love for you, his life for God's kingdom. But what would you do if you were facing death because of your status as heaven's ambassador? What would you do? And this may come ahead very soon. We know that things are happening in the world. Things are lining up. What would we do in that case? So there is power to stay in the ministry because of this blessed hope of the return of Jesus Christ and our eternal life, and because of the guarantee of the Holy Spirit. Let us go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. It's the same letter, same train of thought. Paul says, "Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry," all of us have a ministry for the Lord, "we do not lose heart." He says, "We do not lose heart." A little farther on, he says, "We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." And then he goes on to speak about the body, that, you know, this is the temple we live, but we're looking to be in the presence of the Lord. These are very difficult verses. And he describes his weaknesses in the body, his feebleness, the perils that he goes through in his ministry. And then he naturally moves on to describe what or where does he find an encouragement. And he says to the Corinthians, who are also losing hope, he had to remind them that their resurrection was assured by the down payment, that is the word that he uses, the earnest, the down payment, the guarantee of the Holy Spirit dwelling in them. That is found in 2 Corinthians 5, 1-10, especially in verse 5, which mentions the Holy Spirit as our guarantee for eternal life. This is a universal principle. There are perils. There is sacrifice in the life of ministry for God. When we share reconciliation with the world, we face challenges. But we do not despair because we have a powerful hope, life eternal, for which the Holy Spirit is the first foretaste, the down payment. But then there is yet one greater motivator, one greater thing that he shares with us, to continue to share the gospel. So number one was the judgment, the imminent judgment. Number two was the hope that we have in Christ. Number three is love. Love. Some people have said that the greatest motivator on earth, aside fear, is love. And some examples of this is the other day I saw this video of this woman. She didn't look strong at all, but she was lifting this car, very heavy car, because her baby was about to be crushed by it. Where did she get this strength from? Because of her love for him. And back in the days in Europe, kings used to be married for political reasons. And some kings would forsake the opportunity to be the king for love. They say, I do not want to marry to that person, I want to marry to the one I love, even if that means forsaking my kingdom. So love can be a big motivator to do mighty things, to do great things. And it is in this scene of the substitutionary God that Paul exclaims, for the love, this is here in verse 15, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15, as he sees God doing this transaction of substitution, Paul exclaims, for the love of Christ controls us, compels us. Having concluded that one died for all, Jesus Christ, therefore all died, and he died for all so that we might live, we who live might no longer live for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf, on our behalf. So Paul says, the other motivator to live for God is love. Now this word love can be seen as the love that comes from God, or our love towards God. So they call this from a plenary genitive, which means, indeed, actually means that it is the love that comes from God, as we see him on the cross dying for us, that motivates us to return our love to him in our deeds, in our words, in sharing the gospel with the world. So it is a plenary genitive. We share, we receive the love, motivates us, and then we return that love to God by doing these things. And this is found also in the Bible, because we read that in Romans 5:8, God demonstrates his own love towards you and me, toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So we see God's love manifested. And then as a response of this love, it leads us to be faithful to him. And we read this in 1 John 4:19. It says, we love him because he first loved us. So that is the love that speaks there, the love that motivates us to share the gospel with the world, to not hide our Christianity behind our walls in the church, behind our house, behind our own little devotional life, but to be outspoken to the world about this. And this speaks of a life of ministry, ambassadorial ministry, for all believers, living a sacrificial life motivated by the imminent judgment, the resurrection of the Holy Spirit, and the love of Christ. And I want to do a small activity with everybody here today. I want you all to close your eyes for a second. Close your eyes and imagine Jesus saying these words. Imagine yourself in your favorite place with Jesus. He's saying these words to you. Oh, my beloved son, I died for them, those lost souls that you see in the world. Won't you look after them? They were worth my blood, and are they not worth your labor? I came from heaven to earth as a servant to seek the lost. And will you not go as an ambassador to the next door or city? Them, I emptied myself of power in order to do this. But it is your honor to be so employed, as I invested you with power from high. I will judge the world in righteousness. Will you not warn them? I have suffered so much for their salvation, and I am willing to make you a co-worker with me. Will you take up that which rests upon your hands? I pray for the Father's kingdom to come to earth. Will you, as my ambassador, help to establish God's kingdom with power and authority? And as you remain with your eyes closed, let us go to a word of prayer. Holy Father, today you have spoken to us. You have spoken the most important message for humanity. Message of reconciliation of sinful human beings to a holy God. Father, help us embrace this message. Help us live this message. Help us share this message. Help us be one with the message. Help us to see the authority and power that we have to resist evil and do good, to resist cultural practices that go against your kingdom, and to be as the prophets of all and as Jesus Christ, actively seeking for social justice, seeking to help those in need out there, to show them the manifest kingdom here on earth. Help us to be faithful ambassadors of Christ. In the name of Jesus we pray.